I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing within the gates, O Jerusalem." Psalm 122, verses 1 and 2. And Psalm 122 tells us of the time that King David, with deep emotion, was looking forward to going to Jerusalem. He is remembering the gathered community coming together to worship and to pray for the peace and security of the believing community. The thoughts of just that, entering the temple, filled his heart with joy. Then he relished the experience of actually standing within the city gates. Of course, we are the new temple and dwelling place of God. But just coming together to do what David did should fill us with the same joy. I want to welcome everyone here for this morning's service. It's a pleasure to see you. Welcome everyone downstairs, and I hope you can hear us. And it's just awesome that we can gather after 3 months. So let us worship our Lord as one. Just remember for the folks downstairs and in the future too, anybody going downstairs to dress a little warmer because it is a little cooler. A couple of announcements that we have. Okay, we will be calling you later on this week with the changes. Phase 3 is in effect on Sunday, the next Sunday. So we will be in contact and just what the rules and regulations are going to be. Pastor Brian and Colleen, they are off to see their daughter in Alberta, and we'll be back here late Saturday, but for next Sunday's service. Pastor Brian also is planning to have 2 life groups in July and August. So if your life group is closing for the summer months, and or if you wish to continue in small group fellowship, please contact Pastor Brian. Just an announcement regarding the elders board. Brother Al Smith has decided that he would step down until September. Also, for tithing and offerings, we have baskets set out at the sanctuary. Upstairs is at the back, and downstairs it'll be on the table beside the TV. At this time, let us go for opening prayer. Let us go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are so thankful that we can gather here as a community, as a church family. Lord, we can come to you in prayer, in song, in worship, praising your name. Lord, we just pray that your Holy Spirit will fill us, will prepare our hearts for the message that you have given Kevin to give to us. Lord, we also just pray that you be with Kevin and the Holy Spirit will guide his words. Lord, at this time, we also want to pray for our sick and our elderly. Lord, just look after our elderly, keep them safe. We want to pray for Wayne, for Kim's dad, as he's recovering from surgery, and also for Jerry, for his recovery, and thank you for answering the prayers there. Also, wish to pray for Marin, as her headaches continue. Lord, we just pray for your healing hand to be upon her, and also want to pray for Earl's mom, who has been hospitalized, and we just pray that she is on the path of health again. Lord, just pray for safe travels for Pastor Brian and Colleen, and they are really pumped to see their family, and Lord, just be with them, guide them, and bring them back safely home to Manitoba. Lord, too, pray for our government, for our leaders that make the decisions for the health departments. Lord, just guide them in their decisions, and we are just looking forward that we can gather in bigger groups following next Sunday. Also, Lord, this time we also want to pray for the tithing and offering. Lord, you have given us so much. We are so blessed here in this country. And Lord, now we have an opportunity with a joyful heart to give back a portion to you. And Lord, we just pray, take these offerings and multiply your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. How awesome it is that we can come together as a church body and worship our Lord and Savior. And it just seems every week is something different. And hearing the phase 3 that will be taking place most likely June next Sunday, means we can double capacity up here, double capacity downstairs. So just exciting things. And how it's just so exciting that we worship a living Savior. And He is over all, He's through all, He's in all. And He has given us victory. I invite you to stand as we sing together this morning.
Thank you. plunge me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Amen. Thank you.
Activity with you outside. So if you would meet Alyssa at the back door, all right, and you can, Kevin will guide you to exactly where you want to go or need to go. Linda and I would like to continue to be in God's presence as we read a psalm from that is a prayer. We know that bad things do happen, and they happen to good people. And I want you to listen for that in this passage, the affliction and the persecution that comes upon us. You are my portion, Lord. I have promised to obey your words. I have sought your face with all my heart. Be gracious to me according to your word. I have considered my ways and have turned my steps to your statutes. I will hasten and not delay to obey your commands. Though the wicked bind me with ropes, I will not forget your law. At midnight, I rise to give you thanks for your righteous laws. I am a friend to all who fear you, to all who follow your precepts. The earth is filled with your love, Lord. Teach me your decrees. Do good to your servant according to your word, Lord. Teach me knowledge and good judgment, for I trust your commands. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word. You are good, and what you do is good. Teach me your decrees. Though the arrogant have smeared me with lies, I keep your precepts with all my heart. Their hearts are callous and unfeeling, but I delight in your law. It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees. The law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. Your hands made me and formed me. Give me understanding to learn your your commands. May those who fear you rejoice when they see me, for I have put my hope in your word. I know, Lord, that your laws are righteous, and that in faithfulness you have afflicted me. You have afflicted me. May your unfailing love be my comfort. According to your promise to your servant, let your compassion come to me, that I may live, for your law is my delight. May the arrogant be put to shame for wronging me without cause, but I will meditate on your precepts. May those who fear you turn to me, those who understand your statutes. May I wholeheartedly follow your decrees, that I may not be put to shame. My soul faints with longing for your salvation, but I have put my hope in your word. My eyes fail, looking for your promise. I say, when will you comfort me? Though I am like a wineskin in the smoke, I do not forget your decrees. How long must your servant wait? When will you punish my persecutors? The arrogant dig pits to trap me, contrary to your law. All your commands are trustworthy. Help me, for I am being persecuted without cause. They almost wiped me from the earth, but I have not forsaken your precepts. In your unfailing love, preserve my life, that I may obey the statutes of your mouth. Your word, O Lord, is eternal. It stands firm in the heavens. Your faithfulness continues throughout all generations. This is the word of God to us.
Morning, everybody. Long time no see. This is weird. I had to preach this sermon once already this morning. I've never done a back-to-back before. Thank goodness for the cup of coffee in between. Anyone else got the morning jitters? Okay, that means I'll just ramble on and on and we'll get through this really quick. I did something at the first service this morning that I want to try again right now, and the bar was not set very high by everybody in the first service, but I realize that there is a gathering in the basement as well, and because we are one body, I wanted them to be included. So if you can hear me, which you should be able to through the speakers, give me a shout and a clap. Just let me know that you're down there. Let us feel as one this morning. That's pretty cool. This morning, as I was driving to church, the Lord hit me with something, and I almost switched gears completely to preach a whole different sermon just off of what he showed me, but I had this profound revelation as after a season of absence, we get to gather together in unity as one body once again. And the revelation was this, just a snapshot of the Tower of Babel. Because God says, when the tower was made, if them, as one people, are capable of this, nothing will be impossible for them. So let's confuse their language. And because they were on the path of destruction, God confused their language to disrupt the spirit of unity that they had so evil wrapped themselves around. And then we come to the day of Pentecost, which was just a couple weeks ago. And it's an incredible day because it's the birthplace of relationship with the Holy Spirit. I don't think we give enough glory to what the day of Pentecost was. where the Spirit comes and dwells among us, with us, in us. And my revelation was this: if at Babel God disrupted their unity and confused their language, on the day of Pentecost, they all started speaking in tongues and he unified their language, because as one body, nothing will be impossible for them. And that was the mandate for the church. So as we get to break out of this season and come together once again as a body unified in the purpose of Christ, just remember that nothing is to be impossible for us with the Holy Spirit. Now, rabbit trail over. Thank you. That was a good rant. Appreciate it. How about that wind? I learned a very valuable lesson this week. Yesterday, as many of you know, I have recently got into the cattle industry, which means I have a stockpile of stuff that comes out of a cow. So yesterday was my yard cleanup day, and I borrowed a skid steer from work, and I was making a pile, and for hours just piling this stuff up, and that wind, I must say, became my enemy. And I don't know about the rest of you, but the wind is a shortcut to the angry valve that is in my heart. A real windy day brings the mean out of me like nothing else on the face of the earth. And yesterday, as I was piling up all my stuff, that wind became my enemy very, very quickly. Now, the analogy here, as I compare to the season that we've all come through, is that what I faced was a literal crap storm. For most of us coming through this season, we have experienced the depth of humanity in its depravity through Facebook and Instagram and all these media outlets, through the news. We have experienced a metaphorical, worldly crap storm. And I apologize for my language here, but the analogy is significant. Because in a crap storm, and this is what I learned yesterday, whether metaphorical or literal, the best thing you can do is keep your mouth shut. As I said, the wind in a storm can be the fast track to anger in my heart. I realize that, I confess that. But it revealed a lot to me about the character of our enemy, the devil, who the devil is. And see, I think for a lot of us, in our picture-shaped imaginations, we like to see God on one side, the devil on the other, in this tug-of-war of character. That God's constantly pulling us one way, the devil's constantly pulling us the other, and we're caught in this tug-of-war, you know, the angel and the devil on each shoulder kind of mentality. And I've come to realize more and more that that's just not the case. Scripture says that if God is for me, who can be against me? So this tug of war that we have in our imaginations, it doesn't really exist. The tug is only one-sided. But as I've learned through the wind, the devil's tactic isn't to pull the other direction. It's to stir up the wind. See, when it's windy, he can upset my pace. And when my pace gets upset, or my process, if you will, the order of things in which I like to accomplish my goals or head in the direction that I feel has been set before me, when my pace and my process get interrupted, my heart becomes angry or bitter or fill in the adjective, whatever sin the enemy tempts you with. And see, in our illustration, if God is over here, he set the path, he has called you forward, the enemy's game is to disrupt your pace or the process of how you're going to get there, so that way your perspective is off. For me, it's the wind. I want to give you another story of how I was so rudely interrupted in my process. And that is a story back in 2014. And I know I've told it to you many times, but you're going to hear it again. A story of my brother and I, Jordan, headed to a concert in Minneapolis. And now, if you look at me and perceive through my appearance what kind of music I listened to, I was very excited to get to this concert. It was the kind of concert where you get to swing your long hair and really go wild out in a crowd of people. That thrills me. I love a concert setting. But in this case, we had paid money for our tickets, we were headed to Minneapolis, and if you know me, showing up on time is often a struggle. But for this concert, I was prepared because I was not going to be late. This was where I wanted to be, and Jordan and I went for supper. It was 4 o'clock. The concert started at 7. I was bound and determined to be there, and then I hit I-95, which the thing I didn't account for was rush hour traffic. Mistakes were made, because when I hit I-95, I saw the sign that said 70 miles per hour. Rush hour traffic means speed is zero. At best, we crept along at 10 miles per hour. And again, those seeds in my heart began to bloom into something that wasn't pretty. Because my process and my pace, preventing me from getting to my destination, had been disrupted. So with my eyes on the prize and I'm sitting at a standstill, I realize that there's something also wrong with my GPS. And I look at my GPS as the path that I am on crawling forward seems to start to vary from the path that I'm supposed to be on. And I realize that the street I'm supposed to be on happens to be directly beneath the street that I am currently on. So now I'm headed in the wrong direction. My path, my process, have been severely interrupted. And then the GPS tells me to stay left on I-95. Or sorry, it says keep right on I-95. So I pull into the right lane. And I'm bogging down the right lane, not realizing that there are two exit ramps coming off of I-95. So to stay right on I-95 actually means being on the left side. So now I am lost beyond lost. And very, very upset internally. And Jordan recounts this moment as the only time in his life he's ever been afraid of me. Because that hand of mine clenched up real good, cocked itself way back here, and drove itself so hard into my steering wheel in the middle of bumper-to-bumper traffic that for the remainder of the life of this vehicle, there were 4 knuckle prints in the Chevy emblem in the center of my steering wheel. We did eventually make it. That's not the end of the story. After a very long time and several hours in traffic of a very angry and disgruntled Kevin, I finally pulled over at a baseball field, able to see our destination off in my sights. And we got out and on foot sprinted across 8 lanes of traffic and over a bridge to where we needed to go. We ran for 2 miles, and Jordan says, "I didn't think you could run that fast." I was motivated. I tell you this story because of a series of events. When my pace was interrupted, it affected my position. My position became that of somebody who was stuck in traffic. When my position changed, it altered my perspective. My perspective was, we're not gonna make it. I'm stuck, I can't move forward, I'm in a bad frame of mind. My heart is angry, my perspective was twisted, and the end result when we got to the concert took effect in my posture. Because like I said, when you look like me and you just love giving it all you got in a mosh pit, My legs were so numb from having run 2 miles that I just sat in my chair and watched the whole thing. So the end result of what I was anticipating when I got there wasn't what I got to experience because my posture had now changed. And these series of words that start with a P had an effect on the final outcome of my experience. Now, perspective is, I got to my destination, I got to see what I wanted to see, but because things had changed within me so much, I was not able to take the correct posture in my experience. Let's open the word of the Lord. Today, I'm just going to begin with a word of prayer, and if you have your Bibles, let's go to Luke chapter 10. It won't be on the screen, so follow along in the written word if you can. First, let's pray. God, I thank you for your word and for your revelation. I thank you that you have called us to a spirit of unity. And as we dissect the message that you have for us today, that you have for us this morning, I just pray that it would take root. I pray that we would see things in a new way, that we would have a new perspective, and that we would not be shaped or influenced by the way the enemy pulls against us, but rather we would set our sights and our perspective in alignment with what you have called us to, and not be distracted by the way the storm can swirl around us. So I just pray this in Jesus' name. I lift this up to you. I commit it to you. Amen. So everybody in Luke chapter 10, this morning we're going to compare and contrast two stories of two characters we know as Mary and Martha. Now, at least in my Sunday school upbringing, we always focused on how not to be a Martha and that we should all be like Mary. And I think as we unfold things today, we might have a different perspective of the character of these two women. But we're going to start in Luke chapter 10. In verse 38, it says, "As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, 'Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me.' 'Martha, Martha,' the Lord answered, 'you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her.'" We're presented with two different characteristics of these two women that relate to how we posture ourselves before Jesus. You see, Martha is consumed by the pace at which she feels is necessary to reach her destination. And see, the funny thing about pace, as I was talking about how the devil works earlier, I was driving one day and I just committed to this idea that the character of the devil is the person who, while you're driving along, doing 100, because that's the speed limit, pulls in front of you and goes 95. Because when somebody pulls in front of you and goes 95, you weave out and you see that there's oncoming traffic. The space between you isn't enough that you can pull out and pass. So you end up back behind that person who's doing 95, and you are stuck. The pace causes a grievance in your heart. Martha is grieved by the pace because Mary is seated at the feet of Jesus. Mary has taken the posture that Jesus is demonstrating. When he sits, she sits. And so she's come in this place of worship. She bows down before Jesus. And because Martha sees a different destination, she is upset by the process. And her perspective of the situation is tampered with. Jesus rebukes her and says, Mary has chosen what is right. Get your mind right and see things through the right lens so that you can come and sit at my feet also. See, it wasn't about the preparation. It was about his presence. We have to start there and then turn the page. We've got to go into John chapter 10. And we're going to spend, chapter 11. We're going to spend a lot of time in this passage here because I think our perception of who Mary and Martha are gets radically flip-flopped as God reveals to us the same plan and purpose for our posture before him. John chapter 11. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. Now I have to pause there for a second for two reasons. Number one is that John, as a writer, is an artist. If you want a powerful sit-down reading, read John in its entirety in one sitting. Because the way he weaves this story together from an artist's perspective, not chronological events necessarily, but because there's ideas he wants to wrap together and interweave as we explore the word that he's put on the page. We begin here knowing John is up to something. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. If you're to continue reading, you will realize that detail of the story hasn't happened yet, according to John's gospel. We have to wait until chapter 12 in order to read about what John just described in chapter 11. John is letting us know that there's something about Mary's character and her transformation that we have to look forward to. There's something coming up. We need to focus on Mary for a little bit as we go through this process that John is unraveling. She was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. When he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Again, we need to stop and look at the audience here, because I don't know in your imagination, but in mine, whenever Jesus speaks, I assume that he just turns and directs whatever he has to say to his disciples. Because that's how I read it as someone who's following or trying to be a disciple. I say, oh, that's who he's talking to. Jesus is speaking to the messengers. The messengers have come to say, Jesus, this is what's happening. And Jesus says back to them, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory so that God's Son may be glorified through it. The disciples heard it, but it's directed at the messengers. Why? So the messengers can take the message back to Mary and Martha. Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. So now the message that the messengers are taking back to Mary and Martha is that this won't end in death. It's for God's glory, so God's Son may be glorified through it. And Jesus isn't coming with us. In something that was anticipated or expected to be Jesus is coming, let's grab him by the arm and bring him along, is now Jesus saying, you go on ahead of me, I'll get there when I get there. Then he said to his disciples, let us go back to Judea. But Rabbi, they said, a short while ago the Jews tried to stone you, And yet, you're going back there? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees this world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light. I've always thought in reading this passage, because we go, Lazarus is sick, Lazarus dies, Lazarus is raised from the dead. Spoilers. Lazarus is raised from the dead. We have this random verse in here. Jesus says to his disciples, are there not 12 hours of daylight? He starts talking about light again. And like I said earlier, John is an artist. He's got details interwoven throughout the whole thing he wants you to pay attention to. And if you flip a page back where Jesus is at the Feast of Tabernacles, he says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness. So when he says, are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees this world's light, meaning regular sunshine, and thinking the light will direct our path. He says, it is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light. Jesus is reminding them that he said, I am the light of the world, and there's darkness over there. To come against the darkness, I need to show up. They can't take my light from me because I am the light. So where darkness is, I need to go. They can't put out what isn't theirs. After he said this, he went on to tell them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. And God bless the disciples, because this is really funny to me. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get better. Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and for your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Then Thomas, called Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, and this cracks me up too, let's go too. We might as well die too. Yes. Let us go also go that we may die with him. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. And I don't get how this adds up, because Jesus waits for 2 days, but when he finally shows up, he's been in the tomb. So not just dead, he's been in the tomb for 4 days. So he waits around for 2 days, and then I'm just going to assume that he took the scenic route to get where he was going. Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed home. Now remember the word posture. Martha heard Jesus was coming. She went out to meet him, but Mary stayed home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she told him. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world. And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. And Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" I read that as an extended passage because we really need to dive into the character of Mary and Martha. Just like in our first story, we get the revelation of Martha first, the pacemaker, the woman who runs out to meet Jesus. Did you notice the difference in their response? It's subtle but important. Martha says to Jesus, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." Now, if we remember the pace that Jesus set in arriving at his destination, you can see how the heart of these women would be grieved. Because if Jesus had left when he was supposed to, things could have been different. "Jesus, we sent word to you, we petitioned you, we came humbly before you, knowing that you are God and you can do all things, and then you left us high and dry. Jesus, here's what we know you could do, and yet here we are in this position, and you want to know something? It's your fault, because we sent word to you on time." That one stings a little bit. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. Flip back to the messengers who brought this message saying, "The sickness will not end in death. It is for God's glory so that God's Son may be glorified through it." So in her perspective, she still sees that even though this didn't end the way I wanted it to, God is still at work doing something because he said to the messengers, this is how it was going to be. So Jesus, because I know you are who you say you are, come and do what you said you were going to do. And Jesus responds to her in grace and says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live." Mary comes into the picture and says, "Lord, if you had been here..." See, she wasn't even that excited to run out and meet Jesus in the first place. But she says, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." See, what she lacks is the humility that Martha had. Where Martha, who had once been rebuked before about the pace she had set, maintained a proper posture before the Lord, and she was able to keep her perspective on what Jesus was doing, not the process that she thought he was supposed to do. Mary, who at one point found herself in the posture seated before the Lord in worship, with her mind engaged on what he was doing and not on the preparations that needed to be done around her, has now flip-flopped into a place where she's let her perspective be deceived. "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." Jesus, this one's on you. When he saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. And we all know it, we all quote it. And Jesus wept. I can't, in all my study, wrap my head around this idea of Jesus weeping when he knows what he's about to do. We hear it, and I agree with it, that he was so moved by compassion at the stirring of the hearts of those around him that his compassion compelled him to tears. I get that, I agree. But I think what really stirred him to weep, not just shed a tear, but to weep, was that he looks at Mary and thinks, I told you I was coming. How can you be so distracted that you have forgotten the words that I sent ahead of you to tell you what I was about to do? Mary, you need to celebrate because I'm at work here. I'm here, I made you a promise. Jesus had sent word, he said, the sickness will not end in death, it is for God's glory. Mary, you know that the glory of God is about to be revealed, and yet here you sit. Because her perspective had been warped by the process that she wasn't expecting. Jesus wept. I told you what I was doing. Verse 38. Jesus, once more, deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he's been in there 4 days. Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? That was the message that I sent ahead of me in the first place. Did I not tell you? So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me, for I knew that you always hear me. But I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. Now this is directed at the disciples, because he said, Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I'm glad I wasn't there, so that you may believe. But let's go to him. Here Jesus says, thank you, Lord, for hearing me. This is what I prayed before this whole process even started, that in the end result, your glory would be revealed. So I thank you for what's about to happen. For the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. I started this passage saying that we need to flip over to chapter 12 to read the ending. We begin with this outline of who Mary and Martha are, in a description of a story that we haven't even read yet. So we begin in chapter 12. This is where John finishes this narrative. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus arrived at Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth about a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. As we tie the whole story together, Mary, who meets Jesus at the tomb, offended by his pace, grieved that he was not quick to respond according to her expectations, shifted her position into that of a mourner. It affected her perspective. And she saw the now, not what Jesus was doing. And the result was that she forfeit her posture. She surrendered her worship because of the series of events that led up to it. She lost her worship through a lost perspective. She forfeit her position because she was offended by Jesus' pace. At the end of our story, she begins in worship at the feet of Jesus. Her perspective is that of a child of God. Her perspective of Jesus is that he's not done his work yet and that there is more to come. Her position is surrender. And the pace, and get this part, using the nard, which was for Jesus' burial, which was to anoint him in death, becomes the nard that she uses to anoint him king in his life. The pace of Jesus, according to what she would have once expected, has changed because her posture began in worship instead of ending in it. So I challenge you with that this morning, as we may face the crap storm that is going on, that if we begin in a posture of worship, that's not our destination. If we begin in a posture of worship, we will maintain our perspective of what God is actively doing in the here and now. And if we maintain our perspective, we won't forfeit our position at his feet. And if we don't forfeit our position, we will come into alignment with his pace. And we will partner with him in what he seeks to do, not the other way around. Holy Spirit, I thank you for your revelation this morning. I just pray even for myself, for a humble heart carrying forward, that in the wind, in the disruption of my process, that I would not lose my perspective or my posture seated before you in worship. God, I just pray that over this church in the spirit of unity, that we would be a church that postures ourselves in worship in anticipation of what you're about to do, not in response to what we feel that you should do. God, we give you glory this morning. I just thank you for who you are, that you are faithful and good. I just praise you for the glory of your name. Thank you. Amen.
Thanks, Kevin. You've given us lots to ponder. So what is our posture? What should it be? Let's stand and let's sing. And may this be a response to what we've heard, to what the Holy Spirit has revealed, and also a moving forward. Everything's on the altar now. No holding back, no holding out. In view of your matchless sacrifice, take every treasure, take this life. All that I am, or all that you are, my Lord, all that I have, for all that you are, you're the pearl beyond price, greater than life. All that I am, for all that you are. selfish ambition and my pride. I'm giving up, I'm letting die. In these empty hands I have it all. The pure joy of knowing you, my Lord. All that I am for all that you are, my Lord. All that I have for all that you are. You're the pearl beyond price, greater than life. All that I am for all that you are.
Give you peace. May the peace of God be with you. Amen.